Good morning, happy Sabbath. Thank you so much for that beautiful rendition of Amazing Grace. And what a fitting song to reflect on as we celebrate the amazing grace of Jesus in communion. I don't know about you, but it's always a special moment when I come to church and I see that the table is prepared and the plates are there. I know that this is going to be a wonderful and blessed Sabbath. So I'd like to welcome you, all of those who are here, those who may be joining us online. We love you. But there's something about being together for communion. And so we continue to encourage you as you are able. You are always welcome to join us in person. And for those who can't, we will endeavor to make sure that we can bring communion to you in the next week or so. I have a few announcements for us this morning. Just to remind you that there is something special happening in the life of the church school on February 11th, we have a pancake breakfast, and so we want to encourage you to come out to have a wonderful breakfast with us. There'll be pancakes and hash browns and veggie sausage and or stripples, and lots of great food. And also, of course, it's a way to support the school. And then as we eat together, there will also be the school constituency meeting. What is this school constituency meeting? It's the opportunity once a year when the school gets to share with you, the church family, their plans, their goals, the finances, and so that you can be informed and that you can vote to approve the direction that God is leading the school in. So we really crave and request and need your support. So come out, eat breakfast with us, and then stay and be a part of the constituency meeting as well. I do have to let you know something that I said last week, feels like yesterday. We're going to change. So we were planning to have our church business meeting on the 10th, but we have to change it because there is a conference Pathfinder program, Pathfinder Synergy, happening the same day, all day, and many of our families will be there. And so we want business meeting to be a place where everyone can be involved and can be engaged. So we are shooting for a date in March, but we will communicate with you when we have that date nailed down. But it will not be next week, Sabbath afternoon. Next week, Sabbath, though, is our church potluck, fellowship lunch. Today is communion, and so on communion months, we shift potluck to the second Sabbath. So we're looking forward to having you all bring your favorite dishes and stay to be a part of that experience. So that will be next week, and we are looking forward to that. Do you have some announcements that you want to share with us from the youth? We're going to invite our youth leader, Ayesh Perez, to come and share with us.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Happy Sabbath. How are y'all doing? Amen. All right, so we do have a couple announcements to make. Today after church, we are bringing back our youth Bible study. I don't know if we have a slide for that, but that is today after church, and that is happening in the new youth room. So if you don't know where this is, that is, if you are entering through the parking lot, it's the first room on your right. It's right next to the family room that you might know of. So we are having our first Bible study led by Sister Brianna. She has been leading these in the past and she's doing a great job. So if you are interested in bringing your youth, though this is specifically for those between the ages of 13 to 18, but those a little bit older are recommended to come as well, and you will help lead out and teach, and but also have a blessing yourself as well, studying the Bible, the Word together. Also, we have another event coming up on the February the 11th, after the pancake breakfast. We'll have it on the screen. Is the Super Bowl watch party. We are hosting a watch party to watch the Super Bowl this year again. Last year was a hit. Everyone had a fun time. So this is going to be at 5 p.m. in the gym. This is the same room that the pancake breakfast is going to be in as well. We are charging $10 a person, and this is just to cover the food that you'll be eating while we are watching. But so we're going to have our Super Bowl watch party on February the 11th at 5 p.m. That's next Sunday in the gym. Also coming up, we do have another event on the 24th of February. This is the first, we're going to be talking about the AY. So on the 24th, is our first AY of the year, and the first AY we've had in a very, very long time. So we're bringing back, this is going to be on every second and fourth Sabbath of the month, but February 24th is our first one starting this season. It's going to be a very, very nice program where we're going to get youth together and we're going to be worshiping, studying the Bible, and building community together. It's going to be right here in the sanctuary, and it's going to be led by Sister Jasmine, who has been spearheading this project of bringing AY back. Amen. So this is going to be after church. I don't remember the exact time. Is it 2? It's 3. 3 o'clock. 2:30. Okay, thank you very much. So 2:30-ish, give or take, on February 24th. That is our first one. But unless something changes, it's going to be every second and fourth Sabbath of every month. And just to bring it back a little bit to the Bible study that we have happening today, that is happening every first and third Sabbath. So there is something happening every Sabbath for the youth, except for the fifth Sabbath of the month if that happens. If your youth is interested, please bring them. There's something happening every Sabbath after church for them. Also, the same day on February the 24th, we are having the Pathfinders are doing a love banquet. This is for those over the age of 17 or 17 and older. It's $15 per person. Bring a date, bring a friend, and we're going to have some live music, some food. This is a fundraiser for the Pathfinders. They are going to the International Camporee in Gillette, Wyoming this year. And so they are fundraising to get their tickets to actually go and also their trip to get there, because it is a 16-hour drive, and a 16-hour drive in multiple cars is not fun. So they're trying to rent a bus and figure out a way to get there, okay? So, if you're interested in helping them out, figure this out, come on over on the 24th in the evening. Please sign up at the QR code on the screen. It's going to be a wonderful evening. We have some of our amazing musicians and bringing the music for that day. So please come and support our youth. Thank you very much. Happy Sabbath.
Thank you very much. I want to mention, I was just made aware that there is a car that is blocking someone in the parking lot. It's a white Volkswagen, and the plate number is CJ15881. CJ15881. If that's you, we would appreciate your help. Thank you. I think that those are all of our announcements. For anything that I may have missed, you can always look in the email that we send out every week, and also the bulletin that we prepare has a list of the upcoming events in the life of our church. Just want to say on my behalf and on behalf of Pastor Felipe, it's a privilege to serve this wonderful church community in leadership. You may notice that he is not here today or last week. We are a part of a sisterhood of churches, and sometimes there are needs at other churches for people to cover speaking engagements, and so sometimes he is asked to help. So he is at Deer Park today, and so our prayers are with him and Sarah, but we appreciate his leadership and ministry here. May God bless us as we worship him today through our communion. And let us have our call to worship. call to worship comes from Psalm 1. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. He is like a tree planted by streams of water that yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither. Or in all that he does, he prospers. The wicked are not so, but like chaff which the wind drives away. Therefore the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. Amen.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, church. It's great to see all of you here in person and online. Let me invite you to praise the Lord this morning with our hymns. Let us reflect on the sacrifice of our Lord Jesus Christ that he made for us to save us. As we prepare our hearts on the for the communion, let us meditate on the words of the prophet Isaiah that says, "He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed." Let's open our hymnals to hymn number 156. 156. O sacred head, now wounded.
The Last Supper was Jesus' last meal with his disciples before his death. Through the service of communion, we remember his choice to intercede on our behalf and to take the weight of sin from our shoulders. We proclaim Christ's death until he comes. For on that glorious rugged cross, when his body was broken for us, Jesus won the victory that we might one day wear a crown. Let's sing hymn number 159, The Old Rugged Cross, 159.
Someday for a cross.
Zechariah 13, verse 1 states, "On that day, a fountain will be opened to the house of David and the inhabitants of Jerusalem to cleanse them from sin and impurity. Jesus' blood is that fountain, which we remember through the cup of communion. His blood, which shall never lose its power. His blood, which has set us free. His blood, whose redeeming love is forever a ransom for you and for me." Let's sing hymn number 336, 336, "There is a Fountain."
Redeeming love has been my theme.
Amen. As we sing our last hymn, let us stand and rejoice in the knowledge that Jesus has paid it all for us. Though we have little strength in ourselves, it is our Savior who has redeemed us in the power of his death and resurrection. His righteousness shall forever cover our sinful stains and leave us clean, washed white as snow in the blood of the Lamb. Let's sing Jesus Paid It All, hymn number 184, Jesus Paid It All. Father in heaven, we thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins. Today, as we celebrate communion, please send your Holy Spirit to guide us and to help us to recognize that we are nothing without Jesus Christ, our Savior. Please bless each and every one. Forgive us of all our sins. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please have a seat.
This time I'm going to ask that we kneel or bow or stand, just so you know we're in the presence of the Lord and we are going to be speaking to him. Eternal Father and O God, we approach the mercy seat this morning with fear and trembling. We ask, O God, that as we come, even though we have come boldly, that you will cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We ask, Lord, that you will look into the crevices of our heart and you will remove everything that is unlike you, so that our prayers will be heard by you, and not only be heard, Lord, but be answered. And so, Lord Jesus, as we come, we ask that you will help us to constantly be reminded of the old rugged cross. It was there that our salvation started. And we know, God, that if we allow you to continue to wrap your arms of love around us, soon we will lay down our burdens and we will receive the crown that you have gone to prepare for us. Lord, we come before you today. We ask that you will help us to see ourselves as heaven is seeing us. Remove everything, Lord, malice, hatred, everything that's caused sin from us, so that when heaven look down on us, they can say truly, truly, that's a child of God who's striving for righteousness. We cannot do it of ourselves, Lord, but we know that we can do all things through Christ, through who strengthens us. So even for those of us who are so burdened down, so heartbroken, crying because of pain, because of the loss of loved ones, whatever that's bringing us down, Lord, we ask that you will help us to remember that through it all, you are there. You have been there all the time, and you are not about to give up on us now. Help us to be reminded that even when we cannot see you, Lord, we need to trust you. We need to trust you, Lord Jesus, where we cannot trace you, and be reminded that all is done by you, that's well. So we need not murmur, we need not cry without hope, because we know in whom we believe. So although it gets very hard sometimes, Lord, here we are praising you. We are lifting up a hallelujah praise to you this morning for waking us up, for bringing us here, for giving us an opportunity to praise your name. For that and all the other things, Lord, the bounties of life, we thank you. And we ask that as we receive these blessings from you, Lord, that we will acknowledge them and we will share them with others. Lord, we are before you this morning rejoicing in a free and full salvation. We are rejoicing, O God, even though the pain is behind us or behind the rejoicing, because we know that you are a God who keep your promises and you will never fail us. So help us to remember that iron sharpeneth iron and continue to lift up each other in prayer, just by even a hug, a phone call, just to say we love you and Jesus loves you too. And as we approach the communion table today, God, we ask that you will remind us. Help us to be reminded, O God, that we have not come because we are holy, but because we want to be holy. So we ask that as we come, you will baptize us anew with power from on high, You will create in us a clean heart and renew a right spirit within us. And you will forgive us where we have failed you, Lord, and help that when we go through the doors of this, your tabernacle today, others will see that we have been with you, because we will be rejoicing in a full and free salvation. So we thank you for hearing us, Lord. We thank you for tabernacling with us from morning until now. And we ask that you will always be with us and help us to acknowledge your presence. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Happy Sabbath. Happy Communion Sabbath. We are blessed to be in God's house on this Sabbath day. We began a sermonic journey last week under the theme House on the Rock. House on the Rock. And the big idea, the driving concept of this theme is that as Christians, as followers of Christ, we need to build our house on the rock as Jesus described it in Matthew chapter 7, verse 24 to 27, where he says, "Therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock, and the rain descended, the floods came, the winds blew and beat on that house, and it did not fall, for it was founded on the rock. But everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rain came, the floods and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it fell, and great was its fall." Jesus tells us that it is his words, his sayings, his teachings that constitute the rock. This is the rock that we must build the house of our life as individuals, the house of our family, the house of our church on. And if we build our house, if we live our life based on what Jesus teaches us, if we believe what he says and do what he tells us to do, we can have confidence that no matter what we go through, we will be held firm. And that's why we practice communion. We don't have communion simply because it is a Christian tradition. We don't have communion simply because it's what we have become accustomed to do as Adventist Christians. We don't have communion because it makes a change from the rest of our worship services, and sometimes the sermon goes long, so taking a break for a little snack helps. That's not why we do communion. We do communion because Jesus specifically taught his disciples to do so, and they have passed it on to us. In John chapter 13, we read about the first communion, and it says here in verse 14 of John 14, John 13, verse 14. If then your Lord and teacher have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. Verse 15. For I have given you an example that you should do as I have done to you. Most assuredly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is he who is sent greater than the one who sends him. If you know these things, Jesus says, blessed are you if you do them. Jesus is letting us know that there is more to following him, there is more to being a disciple, there is more to Christianity than knowing. Knowing is good, knowing is important, but knowing must be followed by doing. Knowing must be followed by doing. And friends, something that you will discover, if you have not discovered already, is that as Christians, sometimes there are things that get in the way of us doing what God has called us to do. Sometimes that can be the world. Certainly the world can be a distraction with all of its enticements and temptations and trials. Sometimes it is the things of the world that keep us from doing what God has called us to do. But sometimes, very occasionally, well, actually maybe not very occasionally, but very ironically, it can be our own habits and practices and traditions from within our Christian culture that keep us from doing the things that God has called us to do. And you might be thinking to me, how is that possible? How is it possible that our Christianity, our way of worshiping God itself could keep us from doing the things that Jesus has called us to do? Well, friend, may I remind you that when Jesus came the first time to the Jewish people at that time, it was precisely their customs and traditions that kept them from recognizing who he was. Let us not presume that we are immune to that. I don't know if you have ever experienced this. Maybe you haven't. Have you ever been in a conversation with someone where they come to church on communion Sabbath and they didn't know it was going to be communion that day? Does that ever happen? If your conversations go anything like my conversations, here's what happens next. Oh no, it's communion. I didn't know, and I'm not prepared. Maybe you've had that conversation. And then the conversation ensues, whether verbally or internally, well, since I am not prepared, I will not participate in communion. This way of thinking, while I believe it comes from a good place, from a desire to show respect and reverence for the communion service, we do not find teaching in Scripture that says if you are not prepared, you should not have communion. Some of you are saying, no, but there's a Bible verse that says exactly that. All right, let's go there together. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 27. We'll read. Well, let's read verse 29, and then we'll go back. Verse 29. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this reason, many are weak and sick among you, and many sleep. And then it continues.
Some of you are saying, yes, see, that's exactly the point. The Bible says if you don't prepare yourself, and what do we mean by prepare yourself? Well, maybe in the week you spent a lot of time praying, maybe you even fasted, you stopped doing the sins that you usually do by Wednesday so you could give yourself 3 or 4 days where you can say, you know, I'm doing okay. If you don't do that, then if you come to church and you have communion, you might get sick, you might even die. You know, Brother Smith died just the week after communion, who knows? Maybe he didn't prepare himself. So in order to escape that, let me rather not take communion than take it unprepared. Now, the Bible says we should not eat unworthily. It doesn't say unprepared. It says unworthily. But if we let the scripture interpret itself, we will see precisely what the Spirit through Paul, the Spirit of Jesus through Paul, was trying to address the Christians at that day and our day about. Go back with me earlier in the chapter to verse 17. He says, now in giving these instructions, I do not praise you, this is Paul speaking, since you come together not for the better but for the worse. Verse 18, for first of all, when you come together as a church, notice what he says, I hear that there are divisions among you. So the first issue at hand when it comes to eating communion in a worthy manner has nothing to do primarily between about what you may or may not have done this week, whether you had 3 days to somehow fix your life so that you could be worthy to come to the table. Paul is speaking about the divisions that the church may have between themselves. And he says, in part, I believe it, for there must also be factions among you that those who are approved may be recognized among you. Verse 20, notice what he says. Therefore, when you come together in one place, is it not to eat the Lord's Supper? For in eating, each one takes his own supper ahead of others. Do you notice what the issue was that was happening there? Let's read a little bit more, see if you get it. Each one takes his own supper ahead of others, and one is hungry and another is drunk. What, do you not have houses to eat and drinking? Or do you despise the church of God and shame those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you in this? I shall not praise you. What is the issue that was happening in the church at Corinth, and maybe in some other churches at the time? To understand this, we must understand that in the time of the apostles, the church did not conduct communion like we do today. How we do communion today is wonderful. We're going to see a wonderful experience later with our deacons and deaconesses. They will serve us. We have the table here. But in the time of the first church, that's not how they did communion. How do I know that? Well, first of all, they didn't have church buildings when this was written. There were no church buildings. The church met in homes. So people would gather together, and much like the Passover was a meal, a supper that they ate, they would have a meal together, and a part of that meal was the unleavened bread and the grape juice. And as they did that, as Jesus said, each time you do this, eat in remembrance of me. They would remember the Lord's death until he comes. Well, apparently something was happening at these meals where some people were coming and eating a lot of food and not waiting for other brothers and sisters who were on the way. And then when they got there, there was no food left. And Paul says, what are you doing? Apparently, there were also some issues and divisions among the church that those perhaps who had the financial means to provide a lot of the food at the meal would eat that food, and then those who came who didn't have much money and maybe didn't have much food would go hungry. And Paul says, I cannot commend you. I cannot praise you for that. How can you despise the body and blood of Christ in this way? Then he continues. Verse 23, for I received from the Lord that which I delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes." Therefore, Paul is concluding, verse 27. "Whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner." What does it mean to do it in an unworthy manner? Where there are divisions among us, and where we are more concerned about getting for ourselves than about our brothers or sisters. "He who eats or drinks in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let every man examine himself, so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup." The verses that we just read, "For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this reason, many are weak and sick among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we would not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened by the Lord, that we may not be condemned with the world." 33, "Therefore, my brethren, when you come together to eat, wait for one another. But if anyone is hungry," what? "Let him eat at home, lest you come together for judgment, and the rest I will set in order when I come." Is Paul teaching us that unless you have somehow prepared yourself and made yourself as holy as possible, you cannot have communion? Is that what this is about? No. This is about not having communion in a divided way, not coming so hungry. Can you imagine what it would be that someone here was so hungry that before we could get to the communion, they came and grabbed all of the bread and they were just eating it on the front row? But wouldn't that completely ruin the communion? Apparently that something similar to that was happening, and Paul said, no, this is not right. Friends, how then do we deal with the fact that all of us are sinners? All of us have sinned this week in thought or in action, consciously or unconsciously. Maybe last night, something happened in your Christian experience that you are regretful of and ashamed. And you came to church this morning and you saw the place and you thought, oh no. If it was last week, I would have felt better within myself. But this week, oh, I feel guilty. I feel sinful. Let me stay away from the table. But friends, this table of the Lord is a symbol of how Jesus saves sinners. It is sinners who need the death of Jesus to cover our sins. If we were perfect, he would not have had to come and die in the first place. And in case your heart still condemns you, the verses that we read before, he says that let's come together and wash each other's feet. You remember the story? Jesus came to Peter to wash his feet. Peter said, no, I don't want you to wash my feet. And he said, listen, if I don't wash you, you have no part with me. So Peter said, okay, well, wash my whole body then. Jesus was like, okay, Peter, you're always a little bit extra. You don't need to wash your whole body. You've already been cleansed. You've already been washed. So foot washing, the practice of what we call as Adventists, the ordinance of humility, we get that not just from ourselves, but we get that from the practice and the example of Jesus. And it provides the opportunity for all of us to experience the cleansing grace of Jesus before we come to the table. And so friends, even if you didn't have a chance to prepare, preparation has been made for you. You do not need to exclude yourself from the grace of God
because you feel that you have not done enough to be worthy of the grace of God. We will never be able to do enough to be worthy of the grace of God. That is the heart of the gospel itself. You know, I'm grateful to the messenger to our movement. God inspired her with something that I think is interesting. I want to read for you as we wrap up here. Commenting on this very passage in Corinthians and on the Lord's Supper, she says this. Notice this. Though Jesus knew Judas from the beginning. Now, was Judas prepared for communion in the way that we think of preparation? He was actively scheming at the table to betray Jesus. Right. So if anyone should have not eaten communion, it should have been him. She comments, though Jesus knew Judas from the beginning, he washed his feet. And the betrayer was privileged to unite with Christ in partaking of the sacrament. A long-suffering Savior held out every inducement for the sinner to receive him, to repent, and to be cleansed from the defilement of sin. This example is for us. When we were supposed one to be in error and sin, we are not to divorce ourselves from him. No careless separation are we to leave him a prey to temptation upon Satan's battleground. This is not Christ's method. She continues a little further down. Heavenly angels also are present. Those unseen visitants are present on every such occasion. Speaking of communion. There may come into the company persons who are not in heart servants of truth and holiness, but who may wish to take part in the service. Listen to what she's saying. She's saying, answering the question, but what if there is somebody here who doesn't even really, is not really committed to the truth, but they want to take part of communion? What should we do? Not only are they not prepared, they didn't pray in the week, they aren't even fully committed. They're struggling. What should we do? She says, they should not be forbidden. They should not be forbidden. If Jesus allowed Judas to partake, and who are we to keep ourselves or others from the table? None should exclude themselves from communion because some who are unworthy may be present. She continues and she concludes. All who neglect these seasons of divine privilege will suffer loss. What am I saying, friends? I'm saying if you are here and you are a believer in Christ, imperfect like me, communion is for you. You cannot make yourself worthy for it. Now, friends, can you even add more blessing to your communion if from the Sunday before the Sabbath you spend more time in prayer and you really come to the Lord and you confess your sins and you sing psalms and you memorize scripture and you fast and you come to church with a testimony? Of course you can. Of course you will make communion a more blessed experience for you, but it will not be because somehow you are now more worthy of it or more prepared for it. It will be because in the week you have been following the way of Jesus. For all these things are things that he tells us we should do, whether the next Sabbath is communion or not. Right? Every week we should confess our sins. Every week we should study. Every week we should fast. Every week we should serve others, not just because communion is coming, but because we are followers of Jesus. But if by somehow, like me, this week, your walk with Jesus has been imperfect, thank God the table is here. For the table is the place where, as the body of Christ, we come together corporately to recommit ourselves to the Lord Jesus Christ. Think about it, friends, and I will end here. There is no other sacred moment in the life of the church where we together, as the body of Christ, commit ourselves to Jesus. A few weeks ago, we had a baptism. Ricky May gave her life to Christ. That was her baptism. We celebrated with her, but we were not baptized with her. But when we have communion, each and every one of us who by faith participates together in one moment, recommit our lives to Jesus and declare again to the world and to the principalities and powers that we do not belong to this world, but we belong to Jesus Christ. O dying Lamb, thy precious blood shall never lose its power till all the ransomed church of God are saved to sin no more. Would you declare that by faith, by being a part of the communion service with me today? Friends, we now are going to break after we pray to go to the ordinance of humility. There are different locations that you can go. There is a room where men will serve each other, which will be in the music room downstairs. There is an area where ladies will serve each other, which is in the gym downstairs. And there is a room for families and couples and those who would like to serve each other in that way. That's in the now the junior room, which was the old youth room downstairs. And we have made provision for those who have graduated from going downstairs. You say, my faith is on higher ground. I'm climbing up from now on. If you want to stay up, you don't want to go down the stairs, that's fine. We have a room here in the pastor's study for you. We want to make provision for you. And there's also going to be a place for our younger children who have not yet made that personal commitment and want to, but still want to be a part of this moment. There'll be a children's story for them there, and we appreciate those who are here. Friends, I'm not trying to force you. I certainly am not trying to guilt you. But I appeal to you on behalf of Christ. If you are a follower of Jesus, however imperfect your way may be, won't you be a part of this communion together with us today? Let us pray. Father God, we want to build our life on the rock. We want to build our house on the rock. Lord, your word clearly teaches us that communion is the gift that you left for your church, for sinners like us, to regularly be able to recommit our way to you. Recognizing that as we walk in this world, sometimes our feet, our lives pick up dirt and dust, and that we regularly need you to cleanse us. We cannot make ourselves holy or righteous. Lord, our desire is to be righteous, is to be holy. And it pains us and shames us when the things that we know to be right, we don't do. And like Paul, the things that we don't want to do, we find ourselves doing. But Lord, give us the courage to put down our pride and to recognize that you are the only one who can truly clean us inside out. By our own strength, we may be able for a week or a month or even a while to keep certain areas of our life in check, at least publicly. But it is only your grace that can transform our hearts to be truly reflectors of you. And communion is one of the moments you gave to remind us and to encourage us of that. Bless those of us who participate. And those of who may not, extend your grace to them. Help them to know that you're saving their seat. And not just at this table, but there is another table that you are waiting to eat with us at. And Lord, our prayer is that none of us, under the sound of my voice, whether in person or online, would be missing at that wonderful supper of the Lamb when the ransomed church of God are saved to sin no more. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Corinthians, 1, 2, 1, 2. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23 says, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Would the deacons and deaconesses join us as we kneel, as we pray for the bread? Jesus, we thank you for your body which was broken for us. You paid the penalty of sin that we could not pay, so that we could have hope of eternal life that we could not earn. Lord, as we eat this bread, may it be a symbol of our desire to consume you in every aspect of our life, in what we think, in what we watch, in the conversations we have, in the way we spend our time and our money. We want our lives to be completely consumed by you. Lord, would you be the thing that gives us the strength and the energy to go on as our daily food gives us physical strength? May you give us the spiritual and emotional strength to be able to make it through day by day. Bless this emblem as we partake, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
Has everyone been served? Then let us eat in remembrance of the Lord. Amen.
In the same manner, Apostle Paul continues in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, saying, "In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant of my blood. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes." Let us all pray as we, the deacons and the elders, kneel together. Let us all pray for the wine. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, that we can come before you, Lord, and claim your mercy once more in our lives. Thank you, Lord, that we know and you've taught us that the penalty of sin is death. And though as Adam and Eve first sinned, Lord, and your grace stepped in and your blood stepped in, Lord, they live hundreds of years. I pray and I claim the same blood, Lord, that you've provided for them and that you provide for us, that it covers our sins, that you forgive us and restore us, Lord, and that one day we can all together and as a church and individually come and praise you and spend eternity with you. Be with us, Lord, as we experience the symbol of your sacrifice for us. May our hearts be changed. May we renew our relationship with you, Lord. May we recommit to you. So whatever we face it with you, with your grace and with your mercy. In the powerful name of our Lord and Jesus Christ, I thank you for what he has done for us, and I claim his promises and salvation through us. Amen.
Thank you.
Has everyone been served? Let us all drink together this wine in remembrance of what our Lord and Savior has done on our behalf. Amen.
Before we leave, we will have an opportunity to respond to the blessing that we have received in communion. I want to invite the deacons and deaconesses to receive from us our tithes and offerings. And while they do that, we will also offer to the Lord an offering of praise in the form of music.
I was taking a trip on a plane the other day, just wishing that I can get out. When a man next to me saw a book in my hand and asked me what it was about. So I settled back in my seat, bestseller I said, a history, a mystery in one. And then I opened up the book and began to read from Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Born of a virgin, one holy night in a little town of Bethlehem. Angels gathered round him underneath the stars, singing praises to the great I am. He walked on the water, healed the lame, and made the blind to see again. And for the first time here on earth, we learned that God could be a friend. Though he never ever did a single thing wrong, the angry crowd chose him. And then he walked on the road and died on the cross, and that was the end of the beginning. That's not a book, that's a Bible, he said, and I've heard it all before. I've tried religion and shame and guilt, and I don't need it anymore. It's superstition, made up tales, just to help the weak to survive. Let me read it again, I said, but listen closely. This is gonna change your life. He was born of a virgin one holy night in a little town of Bethlehem. Angels gathered round him underneath the stars, singing praises to the great I am. He walked on the water, healed the lame, and made the blind to see again. And for the first time here on earth, we learned that God could be a friend. Though we never ever did a single thing wrong, the angry crowd chose him. And then he walked on the road and died on the cross, and that was the end of the beginning. In the beginning, he said with a smile, what more can there be? He's dead. You said they've hung him, put nails in his hands and a crown of thorns on his head. I said I'd read it again, but this time there's more, and I believe that this is true. His death wasn't the end, but the beginning of life that's completed in you. Don't you see? He did all this for you. He was born of a virgin one holy night in a little town of Bethlehem. Angels gathered round him underneath the stars, singing praises to the great I am. He walked on the water, healed the lame, and made the blind to see. For the first time here on earth, we learned that God could be a friend. Though he never ever did a single thing wrong, the angry crowd chose him. And then he walked, died. 3 days later, 3 days later, 3 days later, he you see, he came, he lived, and he died. That was the end of the beginning.
We celebrate the one who died and yet who rose, and that was the end of the beginning. But that is not the end of the story, for he is coming again, and someday soon we will see him in the clouds of glory, and we will be able to join with the angels in singing that great anthem of praise to the Lamb of God, who is the end and the beginning, the Alpha and the Omega, who died and yet is alive forevermore. Praise his name. As you leave, you will have an opportunity, as is our custom here at North Shore, to give an offering to our community services. It would be wrong of us to be so blessed and not extend blessing to others. So as God gives you the ability and you would like to contribute to our community services ministry on the way out, you may. Let's have our final prayer, and we will have our postlude, and we will release you like beacons of joy and hope in the world to take the good news of what you have experienced here to those who you know and love most. Father God, Jesus, Holy Spirit, we celebrate once again the majesty of the cross, the transforming power of grace, and the ability of your Spirit to walk in us and with us, step by step as we traverse life's journey. We are committing ourselves once again to building our house on the rock, to following the way that you laid before us. And this week, as we face the challenges and trials ahead, may we not forget what we have experienced here. And we put the devil and his angels on notice that we do not belong to this world. We are citizens and children of heaven and of the Most High God. And whether our bank account reflects it, whether where we live gives notice to it, we know that we belong to heaven, and we will live as those who know from whence we are from. Thank you. We praise and worship you. We say these things in Jesus' name. And God's people said,
Amen.
Amen. Please be seated as we have our postlude.